Good morning, students. Myself, Dr. Vijender Singh Tawar, Associate Professor in English. Presently, I have been posted at Government College, Gudha, in the Jhunjhunu district. In the series of video lectures, which I am preparing, this lecture, video lecture, is meant for the students of English Literature, BA Part 3rd, Paper 2nd. And the topic on which this video has been made is the liberal use of various myths and images in the Chronicle of Peacocks, composed by or written by Intizar Hussain. Intizar Hussain was born in 1925 and died in 2016. He was a great Pakistani Urdu fiction writer. He has written poems, novels, short stories, so we can say he was a versatile personality, versatile genius. He has also written for two famous newspapers, Dawn and Daily Express in Pakistan. He was honored with numerous literary awards in both India and Pakistan for his contribution in the literature. Actually, he was born in the Meerut district of Uttar Pradesh and brought up in India, but in partition 1947, he went to Pakistan. He was highly conscious of the social and political realities with a deep insight in human nature and circumstances. He was a first-hand witness of Pakistan's true history and expressed it in a humanistic angle in many of his stories and novels. The most prominent set of his fiction is the nostalgia for his native land and a long lost culture. He laments the demise of an era, a culture, and a way of life. He has a brilliant prose style and he can easily evoke nostalgia for things and places of the past. Is every great story has a nostalgic color. He always remembers the past. Past culture, past places, past friends, etc. There is also a very strong sense of belonging with the thousands of years of culture and history of his native northern India. This pluralistic and open approach led him to write timeless literature and earned him great respect among the intellectual literary circles and journal readers in both India and Pakistan. He was given respect by both Indian and Pakistani readers. His philosophy is that one cannot understand the present or future without having a meaningful understanding of the past. Means the knowledge and understanding of the past is essential if you want to understand your present and future. To seek answer of the questions concerning contemporary issues, he explores the medieval philosophy and the tradition of Dastan. Consequently, many ancient epics, mythology, and traditional legends of Arabic, Urdu, and Hindi find a reincarnation in Intizar Hussain's stories. For example, in the short story, A Chronicle of Peacocks, he finds answer to the puzzle of atomic arms race between India and Pakistan in the scene from the epic Mahabharata. He draws characters from the great classic the Mahabharata and shows the futility of war and the importance of universal peace, harmony, brotherhood, and secularism. In this story, A Chronicle of the Peacocks, Hussain describes the pain of partition, exile, and lost memories. The narrator of the story, it is natural that the author himself is the narrator, read a news item in the newspaper. The news was that when the atomic bomb explosion took place in Rajasthan desert, the peacocks living there in peace had been so frightened that they had flown up screaming into the sky. The writer wrote a column expressing his sympathy for the peacocks. There is an allegorical touch in the story. As we know, allegory is a work of art, story, novel, whatever it may be, in which there are two meanings. One is at the surface level, which is told, and another is hidden meaning. Hidden meaning is always very important. So in this story, hidden meaning is more important than the surface meaning. The peacocks of Rajasthan were frightened to death by the competitive testing of nuclear weapons by India and Pakistan in May 1998. The narrator is very fond of peacocks because they represent beauty, grace, peace, and love on the earth. Besides the peacocks, there are many images such as weary duck on the far edge of a dark, oil-soaked sea, the lonely peacock of paradise sitting on the parapet of the terrace of the author, the peacocks of Jaipur, the quail, peacocks, and other birds of Indraprastha, and the royal swans of Mansarovar. They all represent the flora and fauna of nature. The evil spirit of Ashwathama is the symbol of destructive activities of human beings. Through these powerful images of the author effectively shows the futility and horror of war. That is, his story actually is not describing peacock. He wants to show before the reader, before the public, that war is very bad. War is destructive for both the parties, who wins or who loses. The narrator of the story read a news item in the newspaper. The news was that when the atomic bomb explosion took place in Rajasthan desert, the peacocks living there in peace had been so frightened that they had flown up screaming into the sky. The writer wrote a column expressing his sympathy for the peacocks. In the newspaper he wrote, the author recalled his experiences of the time when he visited Jaipur. There he saw many peacocks. They had a quiet dignity and royal grace and a calm elegance. The author felt as if he was in the very cradle of beauty, love, and peace. The next evening he saw the same crowd of peacocks and he thought that they had come there to bid him farewell. Even he was emotionally attached with the peacocks and thought that they were the symbol of love, peace, and prosperity. But after the atom bomb explosion, he had a vision of lonely peacock on a distant hill. The peacock appeared battered and bruised, it's injured. He walked to the wounded peacock, but on seeing a human being, the peacock was frightened with fear and flew away. The idea is there was a kind of relationship between peacock and human being before the explosion and after the explosion. Before the explosion, they were in friendly terms, and after the explosion, human being became an enemy of peacock, and peacock tried to run away from their company. This painful sight brought to the author's mind another image. It was a lonely duck covered with dirty slime and effluents, and it could not fly because poison flows through the veins in his body. The weary duck is the symbol of the horrors of the war between the USA and the Iraq. Saddam Hussein against his countrymen, the Iraqis against the Kuwaitis, and the USA against the Iraqis. It's war, the common factor between them. The poor duck has taken upon himself all the crime man has committed against man. The innocent flora and fauna of nature suffer the punishments. The rich and the powerful enjoy life in luxury. The narrator says, the poor duck had the grace of a prophet of our times. What the author wants to say, that it is always poor who suffer. The rich and powerful, they get themselves protected. The author feels that the cruelties of human beings have crossed all the limits, and the beautiful royal swans have also disappeared from the world. There was a time when both peacocks and royal swans were considered as the kings of the universe. At that time, the lakes and ponds were pure and holy, and the royal swan swam in the lake of Mansarovar. Now the lakes are dry and there is pollution everywhere. Something happened and it has changed everything considerably. One day peacock came and sat on the parapet of the terrace, and the author tried to catch it and it flew away. His grandfather told him that the peacock was the bird of paradise. One day, Satan disguised himself as a blind old man and tried to enter paradise. The peacock felt sympathy for the old man and took him inside the garden of paradise. When God found that the Adam and the Eve committed sin, he banished Adam, Eve, and also the peacock. This is symbolic. Actually allegorical, that the person who were innocent, they were trapped by sinful people, and the result was that innocent people also suffered for their no fault. The narrator walked through the streets of Saraswati, where Sri Buddha had lived long ago. Saraswati. There he saw a lonely peacock on the hill. From there, the author went to Delhi. It was the time of partition and communal riots took place in every street of Delhi, and thousands of people were butchered. Many homes were burnt down. Many people were compelled to vacate the city. The author heard a peacock call from near the tomb of Saint Nizamuddin. The peacock call had come from long. The idea is, it is a peacock has become a symbol to depict the various incidents of violence and crime committed on human beings by human beings. Again, the imagination of the author unrolled to long, long past, and once again heard the music of birds from a garden. He heard the whistle of a quail and the call of the peacock. It was Indraprastha, the city of the Pandavas. The author was glad that thousands of peacocks had come to the garden of Indraprastha, but the moment they saw the narrator, they flew away in terror. Soon he found out that the great criminal of Kurukshetra was following him like a shadow. Who was great criminal? It was Ashwatthama, who released the most dangerous weapon of the period called the Brahmastra. Ever since the Kurukshetra war ended, the evil spirit of Ashwatthama has been wandering there. Kurukshetra war was fought between Pandavas and Kauravas. They were the children of the two brothers, namely Pandu and Dhritarashtra. Dronacharya was their teacher, and he taught Arjun the use of Brahmastra. In the Kurukshetra war, the teacher and his disciple Arjun were in opposing camps fighting against each other. Both, however, had taken a vow never to use the Brahmastra because it would destroy the whole world. Before his death, Dronacharya taught his son Ashwatthama the use of the Brahmastra, but warned him never to use it. But after the death of his father, Ashwatthama released the Brahmastra. On the advice of Sri Krishna, Arjun released his Brahmastra to neutralize Ashwatthama's weapon. When both released their Brahmastra, the fire was so intense that the flames burned all the three worlds. What is called in Hindi, Prithvi, Akash, and Nav, Jal, Thal, Vayu, Sira. Every world was burned down. Vyas Rishi, who was in the meditation, was terrified. He went to Kurukshetra and asked both Arjun and Ashwatthama to recall their weapons. Arjun at once obeyed the order and recalled his weapon. Ashwatthama was unrepentant and said that he would change the path of his weapon and fall on the Pandavas' women folk and destroy their wombs and fetuses. So Sri Krishna cursed Ashwatthama that he would wander alone in the forest for 3,000 years. His wounds would fill with pus and blood and they stink so much that people would run away from him in disgust. The last days of Kurukshetra war were the most fearful. Women of Pandavas wept. There was mourning in every home. In every female, a child had died. Subhadra, the wife of Arjun, wept bitterly because the Kauravas killed her son, Abhimanyu. Subhadra had thought that Abhimanyu's wife, Putra, would give birth to a son and ensure the survival of the Pandavas' lineage. But Uttara fell unconscious after giving birth to a stillborn child. However, Sri Krishna kept his promise to his sister Subhadra and gave life to a stillborn child who became Parikshit, the king of Hastinapur. At the time of his coronation ceremony, Vyas Rishi was there to bless the king. Parikshit asked Vyas Rishi why the wise and the great rishis who had great wisdom and knowledge among the Pandavas and Kauravas didn't understand that war destroy everything, including the victor and the defeated. Vyas Rishi evaded the question and refused to answer it. He, however, indirectly said that during the times of war, even the best and the wisest of men acted as fools, and whatever is fated must come to pass. This is very important statement by Rishi Vyas. And he has given a message that whatever has to happen will certainly happen. Even the wisest cannot stop. The narrator says that the question of Parikshit is still relevant for India and Pakistan. The people of both these countries are brothers, just like the Pandavas and Kauravas in the Kurukshetra war. Both of them possess nuclear weapon, which is the modern version of the Brahmastra. The narrator thought that the evil spirit of Ashwatthama belongs to the Mahabharata and India. Therefore, the spirit of Ashwatthama does not come to Pakistan. He thought that it is confined to a particular geographical area that is called India. But when he reached home at Lahore, he saw the spirit of Ashwatthama standing there just behind him like a shadow. The idea, it is not confined. Evil is not confined to any particular kind of geographical area. It is everywhere. Through this story, the author tells us that we modern people of India and Pakistan must learn a lesson from the Kurukshetra war, that modern nuclear warfare brings total destruction for all, and therefore we should live in peace, brotherhood, and love. The idea is, the author wants to say that we have to learn a lesson from our past, from our legends, and we have to do something that we can make an arrangement that there will be no war in future. If there will be a war, it will destroy everything. Nobody will be saved. Nobody will be safe from destruction. Thank you very much.